Good morning. You all ready to worship? Our today is all about praising God, and we're going to hear in our scripture how Jesus was physically transfigured by the presence of God, and we, the disciples, experienced the greatness of God physically as he's shown. We're going to talk about that, and you're going to hear witnesses and testimonies of people whose lives have also been changed through the ministries of this church and the Holy Spirit working in them. So thank you for being here today, and we have a lot going on, so I'm glad that you're here to experience this Sunday with us. Next Sunday, I'll start a four-week series during Lent, 4 to 5, depends on how we go through the four, called Boot Camp for the Soul. And that's it, right? During Lent, why not use this time to put our soul through boot camp, get our spirituality back on track, get in shape spiritually so we can be good, strong disciples for Christ. So every week we'll talk about things that we can do to strengthen our spiritual life. All right, I have one more announcement. You may or may not know. It's not a secret, but it's just not something people dwell on necessarily. But for 20-plus years, the Christian church has struggled with issues of sexuality. And what do we do with that? Our Book of Discipline is very clear. If you want to know about that, I'll talk to you afterwards of what it says about that. But there are people with all kinds of opinions in the Methodist Church. That's why I'm a Methodist, because we have learned to live together even if we don't always agree. So they're having a special general conference in 2018. The bishops have a commission of people working on this issue. They have promised us in 2018 we're going to address this and make some decisions one way or the other of what's going on, what is our stance on human sexuality, and how that's lived out in the life of the church. So with that said, there's a time of prayer for the commission. Now, Kathy's going to come up here and tell you about it, our lay leader, but I just want you to hear this. What we're asking you to pray for is unity, not necessarily what you want, you know, what the result that you want, but this is about unity of the church, and Kathy's going to tell us about that.
Good morning. The Commission on a Way Forward was proposed by the Council of Bishops and approved by the 2016 General Conference to do a complete examination and possible revision of every paragraph of the Book of Discipline concerning human sexuality and explore options that help to maintain and strengthen the unity of the Church. As the United Methodist Church seeks to find a way to move forward together, we are invited to a time of prayer. Each conference has been given a week to intentionally pray for the Way Forward Commission and for our church. The Florida Conference's week is this week, February 26th through March 4th. Please join us in fasting and prayer as we seek the Holy Spirit to move in and among us, and most especially those who have been tasked with difficult work on the committee. This is a call for the Holy Spirit to work in and through us as a denomination, a church family, individual disciples, and most importantly, as our common identity as children of a loving God. Thank you.
We all have a story. We all have a story of our own healing. We all have a story of a family that's been healed. 4 years ago this month, I was diagnosed with cancer. And I spent a year and a half in treatment. And I'm cancer-free. And it's amazing, and we all have those stories. It's very humbling to know that I stand here today. And so many times I think about these years, and I'm very thankful. There's something else. I never had fear, though. I never had one day of fear. I know my God is my healer. And I pray that for all of us. I pray that you can walk this journey without fear, because he will always be with you every single day. He will walk this journey. He's carrying you through it. So today, as we pray together, know that God our Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit. By the way, that was awesome. Best little sermon on the Trinity ever. We all are here because of that Trinity. So let's always go to God the Father to be our healer. Let's pray. Father, we all have disease. We all have things in our lives that we need healed from. Matthew 1:28, it says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I'll give you rest." The healing doesn't always have to be physical, God. We know that our healing comes in so many different ways. The healing of our spirits, the healing of our finances, the healing of our relationships. God, be the healer in our lives. Help us to go beyond these walls and show the world around us that you are our healer. You are all we need. God, I thank you so much for this family of faith that you've blessed us with and that we depend upon, God. Thank you for everyone whose prayers seek healing for the different people in the church, for themselves, for the people outside the walls. God, come and heal us today. Heal our spirits. Heal our relationships. Heal our finances. And God, heal our bodies. We pray all these things in Jesus' name.
There are really two witnesses to our faith. We heard about how the church is striving together for unity in very difficult circumstances, or what could be. And we heard a witness of healing, wherever she went, of healing, which is so powerful. In Jesus' ministry, there was a day when everything changed. There were several days when everything changed. But what we're going to read today in the Transfiguration from Matthew chapter 17, if you have your Bibles, Matthew 17, 1 through 9, this is where the trajectory of Jesus' ministry changed drastically. He literally reached a mountaintop experience. Now hear this, the word of our Lord. 6 days later, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, and brought them to the top of a very high mountain. He was transformed in front of them. His face shone like the sun. His clothes became as white as light. Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with Jesus. Peter reacted to all of this by saying to Jesus, "Lord, it's good that we are here. If you want, I'll make 3 shrines, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, look, a bright cloud overshadowed them. A voice from the cloud said, "This is my son whom I dearly love. I am very pleased with him. Listen to him." Hearing this, the disciples fell on their faces filled with awe. But Jesus came and touched them. "Get up," he said. "Do not be afraid." When they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. As they were coming down from the mountain, Jesus commanded them, "Don't tell anybody about the vision until the human one is raised from the dead." It's the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Literally a mountaintop experience. In our lives, our faith lives, maybe some of you have already had that mountaintop experience where you just felt the power of God and you claimed your life as one dedicated to God, and now you're living out your faith. And maybe some of you, you're still climbing that mountain. You're waiting for that to happen, and that's okay too. It's part of the journey. Today we're going to hear a few testimonies about people who, in most cases, maybe all, they'll tell you their story, have reached that mountaintop at one point in their life. At some point, they realized God had a call and they entered either a particular ministry or they experienced God in a special way. And they're going to share that story with you. But here's what we all need to remember. Jesus came down from the mountain. And the stories of our ministries, our missions, our life as children of God, this is our story of coming down off of that high place, knowing that we can't always be bathed in light. As disciples, sometimes we have to take that light into the darkness. That's God's call in our life. And so now I'm going to invite first Kathy to come up and talk to us about one way we can invite people of our church to literally dance their way into faith, taking us with them.
Thank you, Pastor Will. My name is Kathy White. Many of you already know me, and I have a riddle for you. What is good for your soul, S-O-U-L, but not for your souls, S-O-L-E-S? Pastor Will's nose. Dancing, right? Dancing. He demonstrated it instead of saying it. Ecclesiastes 1:49 reads, "Let them praise his name with dancing." Years ago, I bought a little book called Dance as the Spirit Moves. I didn't realize I might be in need of a team. I just thought perhaps I would participate in a team. But you never know how God's going to direct you. Praise dance can be a little confusing because it's not intended to be a performance. It's a form of worship, just like playing an instrument or singing. Although, just as all of the other talented people here know, if you say to the dancers, "Thank you," or "What I saw this morning moved me," we certainly appreciate that. But it is a form of worship. And in some cases, someone may not be able to sing. I'm not a great singer, although I lead another ministry that sings. Or even be able to dance, but may be able to use a streamer. One of the young people told me that it's important for young people to also worship in a way they see fit. And I have a big group of young people right here. Is that right? Yeah, see? So we're trying to open up some different forms of ministry and to reach more people. How many of you were here when we did the streaming? Everybody? Good. So we want to take that to another level. One exciting thing about that is we were able to use all ages, from our not really toddlers, but elementary age up to any age. And that was very exciting for us to have a ministry that was open to all people. So we want to take that to a new level now and actually add some dancing. Jude helped me choreograph a song that Kevin approved. So this has truly been teamwork. It hasn't been, I don't mean to say approved, but it helped us pick a song. So it's been a group of teamwork, which is another good skill to learn in church. And so we're going to introduce this Palm Sunday. I've been working with four young ladies. We've only had three practices, and I am already beyond proud of them. A result of some of this is that three of the families represented stayed for Wednesday night service after we practiced on Wednesday. In addition, they've already just started to form a Christian bond. Two of these young ladies are related. The other two did not know each other. So I wanted to have another practice between services, and I mentioned to them that we do this before they went to youth. They said, "Oh, we don't go to youth. We don't know anybody," which is also a lesson in itself. A lot of people would probably go to some event if they knew someone who was there, so keep that in mind. Mean to get sidetracked, but they said we don't know anybody at youth, I went, "Oh, please, you know each other." So we're hoping that will involve into other young people participating in even more events. So we again will introduce this Palm Sunday. We want you to pray for us, and especially me, because as many of you have heard me say before, I was raised Baptist. I'm not allowed to dance in church. Last time I danced in church, it was a fundraiser for the Dominican Republic. I was trying to be discreet. My daughter put it on Facebook, and my brother wrote to me and said, "Are you crazy dancing in church? You're not allowed to do that." So, but it will be a very respectful and hopefully moving form of dance. Thank you very much.
Hello, I'm Matthew. For those of you who don't know me, I play on Wednesday nights for the worship service that night, and I started playing here over almost just about a year ago, and I was suggested to come over and try out and talk to Jude, too, because I played guitar, and Kayla Schellenberger and Hannah Simmons suggested that I go and try out and play for the Wednesday night worship. And me being at that point in my life, I wasn't really involved in too much. I didn't really play guitar all that much. I didn't really worship all that much because I was just coming out of a difficult season. So I tried it out, and just ever since then, I've just felt like we formed a bond of like growing together as a team And doing so has helped me realize like what worship is about. It's helped me grow in my faith. It's helped me just evolve and just try and be a godly man that my son needs me to be and that my future family would need. So ever since like ever since playing Wednesday nights, you know, you form a bond with the people that you play with, and you just, you know, it's an amazing experience to be able to fellowship with the people. Definitely grow in unity and just bond together as a family.
See, that really answers the why we're here. To say, God, you are a wonderful God. You're a powerful God. You're a loving God. And we're here to worship you. You see, this is a different venue than private, personal worship. Like many of you, I know that many times I'll be driving down the road in my car. Sometimes I think I'm not really tuned into driving, and all of a sudden there's a great song that comes on the radio, and I'm just worshiping. And I'm having great worship. Then I realize I almost rear-ended somebody. It's like, come on, Kevin. But we do worship in lots of different ways in lots of different places. My favorite place, you know, outside of here, I have a hot tub. And let me tell you, in the morning, I have my coffee there, and I just worship. Just me and God. It's like, man, I just love that time. I really love that time. But you see, private worship or personal worship and collective or corporate worship are two different things. Because you see, God put us in a family. He designed the church. He didn't intend for us to live our lives alone in a vacuum. And that's why we're here. God loves the church, and he designed the church. Now, I know it seems like I may be preaching to the choir because you're already here. But one of the things that's happening in our country is that people stop going to church on a regular basis. Oh, I'll get it next week. Somebody's in town. You know, I've got friends and family in town, so it's not that critical for me. Well, let me tell you that when you're not here, our body is not the same. It's just not the same. Well, I just want to share a couple verses that are really important to me that I think really kind of put a validation, a stamp of approval, if you would, on why we're here. First of all, it's a mandate. It's a mandate. And this is actually from Hebrews. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Don't let us, so the Hebrews writer says, don't stop meeting. Encourage, admonish, be together. That's really important. Because it's a mandate from God. And the next reason is this. It's because of fellowship. You're all aware of the Acts 2 passage, and I love this. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. That was the foundation of the early church. The men and women that met in homes, they broke bread, and they sang together, and they had fellowship. That is our history. It's critical to the faith family. Here's another reason. As a witness, you are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand and gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Let me tell you, believers, Christians, brothers and sisters, when we worship together, visitors and people who aren't really plugged in or have a real awareness or a relationship with Jesus Christ are watching you. And let me tell you, one of the best places for evangelism is right here. Getting an opportunity to authentically, genuinely demonstrate our reverence and passion for Jesus Christ. And let me tell you, that rubs off. And so just be aware that when you're worshiping here, we don't want you to put on a show. We want you to really get plugged in, because there are very people in this room who I hope and pray leave this place going, man, I don't exactly know why and what they were all about and so passionate about, but they were really, really excited and genuine about what they were singing about and what they were praying about. That's passion. Here's another reason it's really important. It's because we are a family. See what great love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God. That is what we are. For some reason, God decided to put us in this place at this time. How awesome is that? Warts and all, blemishes and all, the bottom line is we are a family and we're in this together. And God wants us to grow in the Lord and advance the chains together. And that's what corporate worship is designed to do. Here's another important reason. The Lord's table. He took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Every Wednesday night, we celebrate the Lord's table. The first of every month, we celebrate it here. There's no incidence or evidence of the Lord's table or communion happening in the Bible by yourself. It's to be done in the family of God. We partake in this together. It's really, really important. I'm so sorry that Jude couldn't be here this morning. She's had a death in her family. And if you don't go or check out the Wednesday night service, you're missing a blessing. She's a powerful, powerful praise and worship leader. And that service is just wonderful. It's a great pick-me-up in the middle of the week. And we always celebrate communion together. That's so important. Here's another reason. Rehearsal. Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. Our worship service is just this amazing dress rehearsal for the biggest celebration that our world will ever know. All of the saints who came before, all the men and women who've died, who have had a relationship with Jesus Christ and are with him, are going to be celebrating together. Isn't that awesome? We are going to be part of that huge celebration. And this is the best dress rehearsal for it right here. You know, you can worship alone at your house, and you can worship in your car. There's no unlimited places where you can worship. But let me tell you, there's a special awakening that happens when we meet together as a faith family. Martin Luther, the real founder of Protestantism, said it like this. At home, in my own house, there is no warmth or vigor in me. But in the church, when the multitude is gathered together, a fire is kindled in my heart, and it breaks its way through. A fire is kindled in my heart, and it breaks its way through. So you see, that's why we're here. I could do a promo for worship. We have over 30 people who are involved in praise and worship here, volunteers, lay ministry. But the bottom line is they are part of this faith family, and they believe that worship is vital to the believer in a collective place. There's a Swedish proverb. Some of you have heard it. It says this. A shared joy is a doubled joy. You want joy exponentially? Come and worship. And let's absolutely exponentially experience just amazing joy so that this world sees who it is that we worship, and how important this God, this Creator God is. Jesus Christ loves the church. He died for the church. He's the bride of the church, and he wants us to honor and celebrate his very presence in our lives right here on Sunday morning. So here we are to worship. Amen. Sister Grace.
Take as much time as you want. They're not going anywhere.
Grace Kripe, and many of you already know me, but I'm here today to tell you a little bit about my life. In Mark, God said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel creation or to all people. How many of you know what sand in your shoes means? It means loving to travel, describes me. I grew up in a very fundamentalist family. We went to the Grace Brethren Church about 15 minutes from where I grew up in northern Indiana. It seemed like every time the church doors were open, we were there. There was Sunday school and church services on Sunday morning, and again in the evening, Wednesday night, we were back to church for prayer meeting. When I started high school, my parents insisted that I had to go to BYF, Brethren Youth Fellowship, that met 1 hour before church on Sunday night. At first, I was reluctant to go, but as I made friends, it became more fun. In BYF, we were taught the fundamentals of the Christian faith. We were trained to lead our own youth group. We took turns leading the programs, and we were taken out and led in witnessing in the community door to door. It was in BYF that I took as my life verse Psalm 32:8. I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way that thou shouldst go. I will guide thee with mine eye. That's the King James Version. I do not remember when I accepted Christ as my Savior. It was at an early age. Nor do I remember how old I was when I was baptized. In brethren churches, you are not baptized as an infant. Instead, babies were dedicated to God by their parents. No water involved. We were baptized after accepting Christ as our Savior. And it was done in a baptismal pool at the back of the stage, like most of those in Baptist churches. Being a fundamentalist church, there were certain restrictions in our activities. Not allowed to dance, wear pants in church, and so on. There were plenty of teachings about the narrow way to heaven and about hell. We were sure of eternal damnation if we didn't know Christ as our Savior. I was much younger than my two sisters and brother. In fact, I don't have many memories of them living at home with us. I was 9 when my oldest niece was born. My age is midway between my siblings and my 7 nieces and nephews. My parents were very involved in the church. They were elected deacons and taught Sunday school. Our church often hosted and supported missionaries. When a missionary goes to the foreign field to serve God, save the lost, they are supported by churches throughout the U.S. They visit these churches when they're home on furlough in order to keep their support money coming in. They often showed slides of their work, and I loved seeing pictures of faraway places. In those days, it was expected that the pastor or another church family would host these for lunch after the service. My family often hosted these meals at our home. I enjoyed hearing their stories. I always assumed I would go to college. All my siblings had done so. My father informed me that since he was paying the way, I had to go to our church college for at least 1 year. That school, Grace College, was about 35 miles from home and very small. The maximum student body was about 350 while I was there. Believe it or not, I was very shy as a student, and it was just easier to finish my education there. Being a fundamentalist college, we had required 30-minute chapel every weekday. You had to have a note from the nurse if you were sick. We had some very stirring chapel services and many boring ones also. On one occasion at a college Bible conference, I was encouraged by the Holy Spirit to believe that God was calling me to the mission field, but I always held back. I told God he could have all of my heart but this one corner. That way of thinking kept me from dedicating my life to God's service in the mission field. Also, I really didn't want to go out begging for support money. I was shy and wanted to support myself. After graduating from college, I taught 3rd grade in the small town where my oldest sister lived. I finally got to know her. I had dodged the missionary calling, and it was easier when I was out of college to avoid those tugs on my heart to become a missionary. I wrapped myself in my teaching. After 4.5 years of teaching in Indiana, the sand in my shoes led me to a job in Australia. I spent 8 months teaching kindergarten in a suburb of Sydney. It was a tough job. I had 38 kindergartners who attended school from 9 in the morning until 3 in the afternoon. There were no printed materials to teach with. I had to mimeograph every bit of work I gave them. But I loved Australia, Sydney in particular. I saw as much of it as I could afford and enjoyed my travels. Now, when I had left for Australia, I had a boyfriend. I thought when I got back home, we'd get married. Instead, a few months later, we broke up. I kept running into him. I didn't have a teaching job. I was tired of cold weather. So I moved to Jacksonville, Florida, where I got a job with the county schools. That was over 40 years ago. I used to say when my mom was alive that I flew home for Christmas to remember why I moved to Florida. My mother was a sweet, gentle, devout Christian lady, and I loved and respected her very much. But when I moved a long way from home, I turned my back on much of my Christian upbringing. I still attended church on Sunday morning. I even sang in the choir, but I didn't attend a church that was very active or alive. There were no Sunday school classes for adults or any Bible study classes. When God began to work in my heart again, I gave up my wild ways and started looking for a more active church and a closer walk with God. I was led to this church, Isle of Faith, became a small group participant and a member of the choir. I realized that I would soon be retirement age, and I was looking forward to it. I listened to a Christian radio station on my way to and from school. They ran an advertisement, for lack of a better word, from Wycliffe Translators. It was about the need for teachers in foreign countries to teach the children of missionaries. It made me think back to my college days and my lack of missionary commitment. Here was a chance for me to atone myself. With my income from teacher's retirement, I would not have to go out and beg for support. I applied to Wycliffe, was accepted, and chose to go to Grace International School in Chiang Mai, Thailand. GIS is a Christian school whose main purpose is to teach the children of missionaries, or MKs as they are known. I was ecstatic. I really felt that I was where God wanted me to be. Now, I had breast cancer and treatment 4.5 years before going to Thailand. I was sure I was cancer-free. However, during a routine physical 2 months into the school year in Thailand, I was told I had a small cancerous nodule in my right lung. Talk about shocked. How could this be? I was here doing God's work. In November, I went to a large international hospital in Bangkok and had surgery to remove the cancer. I was told that I'd probably be on chemo the rest of my life. I was heartsick. Now, I so much appreciated the prayers sent up on my behalf from this church family. I truly felt them. I knew that God was with me. I healed quickly and went back to teaching in Chiang Mai. But after the new year, at my doctor's insistence, I started taking chemotherapy in a pill form, 2 weeks of pills and 1 week off. After the second round of pills, I spent a week in the hospital. Leaning on the everlasting arms was my mantra. The doctor wanted me to take a different form of chemo, similar to what I'd taken before. I knew I'd go bald again and be very, very tired. I felt this would not be fair to my students, so I left my job and came back to the States in April. I admit I was depressed and failure, even though I felt God's supporting arm through this experience. My U.S. doctor ran a full battery of tests on me when I got back home. He said he saw no cancer in my body and that he didn't think I needed any more chemotherapy. What a huge burden. I haven't had any more chemo since I got back from Thailand. That was 11 years ago, praise God. Since then, I have tried to serve Christ here in this church and community. I read to CDC classes and volunteer in a friend's classroom at the school that I retired from. I try to stay busy. One of my goals today is to encourage other church members to go in to a CDC class once a month and read to the class and maybe do a small project with the children. We need to make our presence and support known to the teachers, staff, children, and especially the CDC parents. It is really easy, and I'll help anyone who wants to try it. I continually look to God for his guidance and opportunities to serve him. I pray for his leading in my life. I still sometimes apologize to him for not listening to him earlier in my life. I know he's already forgiven.
Let's join hands with your neighbor. Now we have an opportunity as a family of God to continue in mission and ministry. Well, I ought to lock that door. I'm not going to. But you're all invited to go out this door into the fellowship hall as we celebrate Dawn and Mike and Dawn's service as our church secretary. I mean, she's not leaving the church family, just moving on to a different phase of her career and her life. So thank you, Dawn, and please join us as we unify together over some snacks. Go with God. Go knowing the strength of the Holy Spirit goes with you. And most of all, in the unity of the Spirit, go in peace.